Hello, hello, Mordimers here, and welcome to one more game from quarterfinals of Lindores Abbey Rapid Challenge 2020. There were two quarterfinals, two mini matches. In one, Yu Yangi played against Ding Liren, but I would like to show you first game between Daniil Dubov. He's Rapid ranking 2770. He is known as a very creative player. He's from Russia, and he's gonna play as white. So we're gonna see what Daniil Dubov plays. And his opponent Sergey Karjakin. Sergey Karjakin holds the record of the youngest ever grandmaster in the chess history. He got his title in the age of 12 years and 7 months. His actual rapid ranking 2709, and he's gonna play as black. And once we finish the game, I will show you all the pairings, the semi-final pairings. We're gonna have very exciting games today, so stay tuned, and without further ado, let's see what happened on the board. We have d4 by Daniil Dubov, knight on f6, c4, e6, knight on f3, d5, queen's gambit declines, and now very standard stuff: knight on c3, bishop on e7, bishop on g5, knight b on d7, e3, h6, and now not bishop on h4, which is the most popular, but bishop f4 by Dubov. So moving the bishop to this diagonal, putting some pressure, you know, on these squares, and black has to be very careful. Sometimes it can be very annoying. We have castle by Karjakin, and now what white can play is, for example, c takes on d5, preparing the move, you know, like the developing the bishop, so not losing the tempo whenever the bishop is developed. Then this pawn always can take on c4, winning one tempo. So that is the one idea. So c takes on d5, bishop on e2, bishop on d3 is also playable. Queen c2 is the most popular in this position. However, believe me or not, Dubov goes for g4. G4, we don't see it often, but it was played couple of times. And then d takes on c4 was played already, knight takes on e4 was played already. However, we have c5 by Karjakin. Very aggressive move to the, you know, fighting in the center, making the space for the queen, you know, for this diagonal, also attacking the center of white, and white have to be very, very careful. It's very double edge, you know, position, and it's very also interesting position. And of course, black cannot take on g4, because after rook on g1, look at this, a semi-open file straight on the king. Bishop also pointing on h6, so if the knight is moved, then of course bishop h6. If the knight is defended, h3 always is, you know, on the board, so very bad idea to take on g4. But as I said, we had c5, so something like Tarash variation, but with the g4 pawn. Very interesting, very exciting what gonna happen here. Of course, we have g5 now attacking the knight and the pawn, so something has to be done. If the knight is moved, then of course pawn can take on h6, which gonna be very uncomfortable. So h takes on g5, and now not bishop takes on g5, but knight takes on g5. That's Dubov's idea. And here, of course, we have counter attack in the center. C takes on d4, e takes on d4, d takes on c4, and now not taking with the bishop, but rook on g1, rook on g1. And here, black stands better here, but also have to know what to play. B5, it's very strong here, and followed by queen on a5. So opening this, you know, with the c5 opening diagonal for the queen, this could be very interesting. Pinning the knight, and king is still in the center, and it's not easy, you know, to hide the king. And white really cannot take on b5. That would be really, really bad idea, because e5, with the idea of opening the e-file and attack on the king, which is, you know, still not hide. And it's not easy to hide this king. Very dangerous. So, for example, d takes on e5, queen a5 with check and attack on the knight. So knight have to retreat. And now knight on e5. Queen on e5, so cleaning the e-file, and now it's really bad. Queen on e5, queen a5, and what white can do? if castle, then bishop on a3 is coming, and this is just disaster. Rook can come also to b8, join the party. The bishop can come to f5, you know, and this is really, really difficult for white to defend. So that would be very interesting to play b5 with the plain queen on a5, as this pawn on b5 cannot be taken. And black position is maybe a bit shaky, but it's still slightly better, you know, than position of white with the king in the center. So black should play this way. However, we have knight on d5. Now it looks like this knight, you know, is not covering h5, but queen on h5 is not really great, because after knights from the 7th rank to f6 attacking the queen, so queen has to move, just exchange this bishop, and white don't have the good idea to actually continue the attack. It's very difficult to coordinate the pieces now. There is no bishop, and not really great. So definitely not this way. What Dubov played is queen on c2. Very simple threat. First, we have a checkmate, so black doesn't have much choice. And after bishop on g5, bishop on g5, f6. So Karjakin actually weakened the position of the king, and look at this, the light square are very, very weak here, and Dubov will definitely try to exploit them. So bishop on h6 for now, with the obvious threat of taking on g7. So we have rook on f7, and now bishop on c4, developing move, taking back the pawn, and knight from the 7th rank to b6, attacking the bishop. Bishop can retreat to b3, this is a good move, but Dubov decide with the bishop on e2. And now we have f5, cutting the diagonal from the queen. So now queen cannot, for example, go to g6. So that's the idea. However, after knight on b6, the queen cannot come to a5 anymore. And also, which is maybe more important, black doesn't have the dark square bishop, so the bishop cannot, you know, join the attack on a3, which could be very, very dangerous here. And you know, after bishop, for example, on d7, rook could come, you know, attack the position of the king. So Dubov just castle. He is quite safe here, and Karjakin doesn't really have the great plan here. So he play queen on h4, which is the best move in the position. Now he attacks the bishop, attack also this pawn, so he can win some material. We have bishop on g5, attacking the queen, queen on f2, and now queen on d2, defending d4, and now preparing also to maybe not catch the queen, but at least, you know, kick it from the white base. We have bishop on d7 now, developing the bishop, making a space for the rook, so now the rook can join the attack, and rook d on f1 as planned. We have queen on h2, so grabbing another pawn, rook on h1, and now queen on d6. Queen on d6, making a space for the rook, for example, to c8, and now this would be very, very uncomfortable attack. However, better move would be queen on c7, and it would be better, but it's not easy to understand why yet. The point is, after rook on h3, white of course want to double the rooks and checkmate on h8. Karjakin play knight on c3, and the obvious continuation of course would be b takes on c3, and with queen on c7, as you see, black actually can bring the rook, and that would be quite strong pressure on the king's position. However, what Karjakin did is pretty amazing. He sacrificed the minor piece for the attack. So rook f on h1, and we have knight on a2, so winning the material, queen on e2, and what to play now as black. Checkmate is coming, and I will show you a couple of variations. It's not easy to avoid that, you know, to be okay. So what Karjakin found is queen on c6 with check, king on b1, and now how would you stop the checkmate? G6 of course doesn't work, because you're gonna get checkmated anyway. So that's not a good idea. If you make a space for the king and try to escape, look at this bishop. This bishop, you know, cuts this diagonal, and also the queen is coming. So this also leads to the checkmate. After rook on h8, queen can join the party, so queen h5, and there is only one move, one legal move actually to block. And that's also a checkmate. So this also doesn't work. What black could try to play to is to actually sacrifice the rook, rook on f6. And after bishop on f6, don't take the bishop because you're gonna be checkmated. Queen also always can join also. So that's gonna be a checkmate, but rather queen on a4 first, and after exchanging the queens, bishop e5, and this position have to be played as black, so definitely white have much easier endgame. So if black have to, you know, sacrifice the rook, Sergey Karjakin got the other idea with his check on c1, and he exchanged the queen for the rook, as he already got one minor piece. So we have queen on h1, rook on h1, and now bishop c6, attacking the rook, and now trying to coordinate his pieces, as he have two rooks, so it's quite possible, but it's not easy. He still need, you know, couple of moves to solidify his position. But Dubov, of course, will, you know, put a lot of pressure on his position, so he has to be very, very precise. Rook is under attack, so we have rook on h4. Of course, queen on h2 is coming, so bishop on e4 first, king on h1. And now what Sergey Karjakin had to play, this is the only way to continue, is rook f on f8, because queen on h2 is coming and you cannot really stop it. I will show you a couple of variations, but here after rook on f8, queen h2, it's still possible, you know, to survive, because after king f7, white doesn't really have, you know, good continuation. If queen on c7, then you know, king can go to g6, harass the bishop, and then continue, and it's not so easy, you know, to do anything, as the bishop cannot be attacked by the minor pieces, is on the light squares. Defend also b7, the knight is also defended, the rooks are connected. It's kind of, you know, kind of stronghold, it's like a fortress. Probably it can be exploited, but it's not so easy. And what engine says, it's just, you know, rook h6 is the only way to try to win. Rook h6, can you imagine? And the idea is, because if g takes on h6, then actually queen h5. This is, of course, the idea. But there is no clear checkmate. It's only, you know, better endgame. King g8, now bishop h6. Checkmate, of course, is coming. So rook f7, queen g6 with check. And now after king on h8, bishop f4 with the idea of moving the bishop to e4 and attack this way. And what black can do is moving the knight to d5, exchange the knight and the rook for this bishop, and black have to play with the rook and the bishop against the queen, and queen gonna take on e6 as well, so white gonna pretty easy win that game. So g takes on h6 is not possible. What black have to find is also quite crazy move, bishop on f3. This is the only move, and after queen on c7, king on g8, and now rook on g6 with the idea, mating idea on g7, so rook f7, it can be defended easily, but then queen on g3 with attack on the bishop, and also it's a very, very nice threat, you know, on attack on the king, but the bishop on f3 is very handy now, because it can attack the rook, and rook is quite almost trapped, so rook have to go to e6, and this position have to be played by Sergey. So this is the best position he can achieve. Of course, if Daniil Dubov find rook h on h6, otherwise he probably could handle the draw. But the problem is Karjakin underestimate this queen on h2. Maybe he just missed that, maybe he just, you know, forgot, because it sometimes happen, especially in the rapid chess control, and he play rook on c8, and it's not even a threat. because c1 is controlled by the bishop, and after queen on h2 he just resigned. And he resigned because he just gonna be checkmated. If he try to checkmate opponent, he gonna lose first. And as you see, queen h5, it still works very well. The same idea, whole game is, you know, on the board. So that would be a checkmate. And if black actually try to avoid that, it's possible. Rook f6 is actually the only move here. The problem is white can just exchange the pieces. Just exchange the rooks here, exchange the bishop for the rook, and now white gonna win with the queen against two minor pieces. That should be maybe not very easy, but shouldn't be also difficult to win that game. So this is why Sergey Karjakin just resigned the game. Maybe he didn't see this, maybe he was in time troubles, or maybe he just respects the opponent. He still had the two games to play. However, now I would like to show you the knockout phase. So as you see, quarterfinals ended. Hikaru Nakamura won easily two mini matches against Levon Aronian. He is in semifinals. Magnus Carlsen also did the same against Wesley. So today Hikaru Nakamura and Magnus Carlsen gonna play. Very exciting day. So I'm gonna cover one of the games as well. And we also had Yu Yang-Yi against Ding Liren, where Ding Liren lost first mini match and then won two mini matches. He actually won one game in the last mini match, lost one game, and he managed to draw in the Armageddon. And Daniil Dubov, as you see, he just won today, and this was just decisive. Three wins and just, you know, crushed Sergey Karjakin. So he is the last player who advanced to the semifinals, and we're gonna see their games, you know, another day. And then in June we're gonna have a huge finals. So very exciting games are coming. And if you like this video, if you wait for another ones, just press like. If for some reason you don't like it, press unlike. And if you don't want to miss any others, press subscribe, smash the bell button. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next one.